Remember the night. Remember the feeling. Remember the magic in our lives. You opened up my eyes to a new world revealing. So remember the magic. Just remember.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to episode 11 of Remember the Magic. In this show, we take a deep dive into everything extinct Disney. In today's episode, I will be taking a break from the wonderful world of Halloween and instead be talking about the 49th anniversary of the Magic Kingdom's infamous original e-ticket ride, the 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea Submarine Voyage. Let's begin! The history of this attraction really begins at Disneyland Park in 1959, when the first major expansion to the park took place. Since Disneyland opened in 1955, more and more people began copying the Disney formula and cash grab ripoffs. The most famous of these was probably upstate New York's Freedom Land, which was started by former Disneyland employees. Walt became more and more angry that people were copying his ideas, so he decided to make an expansion so elaborate and costly, no one would dare risk copying it. On June 14th, 1959, the Matterhorn bobsleds, the Disneyland All-Weg monorail system, and the Submarine Voyage all opened to the public. These new rides were so revolutionary and popular that an entirely new ticket class needed to be introduced just to set them on their own tier. The now famous e-ticket debuted along with these three new rides, and not long after, many of the park's most popular attractions were moved from DDE tickets. Needless to say, these three rides were enormous successes, but with Walt always planning for the future, these concepts would not be limited to Anaheim. Fast forward a bit to the late 1960s, when Walt and his cronies began buying up mass portions of admittedly useless then-Florida swampland with the intent to build a massive new empire. While the original plans did entail a larger Disneyland-style theme park, the main focus, at least when Walt was around, was Epcot. Epcot, or Experimental Prototype Community of Tomorrow, was to be a full-blown Disney city, complete with shops, restaurants, office buildings, and public transportation. Unfortunately, Walt died in 1966, but with the land already purchased in Central Florida, the company continued to move forward on the project. Rather than building Epcot right out of the gate, the company decided to make the East Coast Disneyland the priority. As soon as planning started, alongside a few attractions that were to be completely unique to Florida, the people in charge of the project went through the company's archives and picked out various pre-conceptualized attractions to build in the Florida park. While things like the Fantasyland dark rides were no-brainers, Disney debated which of the park's e-tickets would be cloned. Eventually, many were brought over, such as It's a Small World and the Jungle Cruise. The company also decided to bring out two of the three 1959 expansions over in one form or another. The original monorail system pioneered in Disneyland was expanded and now could be used as the main transportation means for the two on-site hotels, as well as the main parking lot. And the topic for today's video, the Submarine Voyage, was brought over and reimagined into the aquatic-themed 1954 classic, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. Since the ride was not being squeezed into an already existing park, it was able to have a much larger footprint in Florida. However, this would cause some problems down the road. With this new version of the ride, Disney dropped the cost-heavy freshwater filtration system and just used an unfiltered saltwater system to fill the lagoon. Disneyland's Submarine Voyage resided in Tomorrowland, but for Florida, Disney made the choice to move it to Fantasyland, kinda near where It's a Small World would be if they had just cloned Disneyland. Anyway, with the resort's opening creeping closer and closer, Disney got to work on the attraction, including the 12 submarine ride vehicles and the 5-acre lagoon. Unfortunately, it was just a bit too ambitious and would not be ready in time for the park's grand opening on October 1st. The attraction did open 49 years ago today on October 14th, 1971, exactly 2 weeks after the park's grand opening. Being the park's sixth e-ticket attraction, its immense popularity was inevitable. People really liked the new ride and thought it was both a worthy evolution to the Disneyland version and also a fun attraction that stood well on its own. Fast forward a lot to 1994, as while the attraction did go through some minor changes in the first 23 years, nothing really changed substantially other than turning off the waterfall entrance effect due to some leaks inside the subs. Anyway, Disney had done veritable oceans of water-based rides, but this was the first using unfiltered water. Unfiltered salt water. Being a water-based ride, the infrastructure had to be restored and renewed regularly, so when a refurbishment was scheduled for late 1994, no one thought much of it. However, it would never reopen. On September 5th, 1994, a few lucky unknowing guests would end up being the last ones to travel 20,000 leagues under the sea in this classic attraction. So, why did it close? And more importantly, why wasn't it announced? Well, you see, the ride was a bit of a nightmare on the management side of things. It was costly to run, high on manpower, and incredibly inefficient due to its slowest loader in the land nature. After the Euro Disneyland disaster, the company was looking for any way to cut down on costs, and unfortunately the subs just stuck out like a sore mariner's thumb. Even Disneyland's version closed in 1998 for the same reasons, but at least there it eventually resurfaced. Also, on a completely unrelated note, upon Tokyo Disney Sea's opening in September of 2001, they built a 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea ride of their own. Quite similar to Florida's in many ways, with the exception of the ride vehicles, which were now completely different. They even put one of the actual subs in the queue! Unknown if it's a prop from Walt Disney World's ride, but either way, it's super cool. Anyway, since the subs were going down for a refurbishment, they were removed without a proper send-off. But more importantly, they had nothing to replace them with. So the lagoon just kinda sat there for a long time. And for a while, the subs could actually still be found there. However, they were removed a few years later. In 1996, Disney officially announced that the attraction would never return, and that same year, a few minor things were added in its place. The queue area was turned into the Fantasyland Character Festival, which was a meet-and-greet location with some previously seldom-spotted faces. Another piece of the lagoon shoreline was turned into Ariel's Grotto, which was a meet-and-greet location with the famous mermaid princess with picturesque views of the lagoon. Both of these locations opened in late 1996, but they didn't really touch the actual lagoon aside from a King Triton statue being added near the grotto. And even then, it didn't alter a fraction of the massive 5-acre ride. After sitting abandoned for almost 10 years, Disney made the choice to demolish the infrastructure left over from 20,000 Leagues. In late 2004, work walls went up and the lagoon was drained. The 7-month process to remove all of the elements from the former ride was long and heartbreaking, as draining the lagoon revealed all the damage that leaving this ride abandoned had done. While some minor things were saved from the ride itself, the only major things that remained were the subs. Of the original 12, one was shipped over to Castaway Key for a new diving attraction, one was put into the queue of the backlot tour at Disney's Hollywood Studios and later into the archives, and the other 10 sat in a boneyard for about 8 years. Eventually, they were stripped for parts, with quite a few pieces being shipped off to Mouse Surplus for auction. With the lagoon now drained, Disney debated what to put in the 5-acre area. Meanwhile, as a placeholder, the charming Pooh's Playful Spot Playground opened in September of 2005. Though behind the borders of that area, the outline of the former lagoon could still be spotted. For years, plans were tossed around, such as a Villains Mountain Flume ride or a Fire Mountain Atlantis-themed hybrid coaster, but none of these ended up seeing the light of day. Eventually, Disney decided to convert the 5 vacant anchors of former Subland and the neighboring Mickey's Toontown Fair into the new Fantasyland expansion. While plans changed a lot throughout the process of this expansion, that deserves a video of its own someday, so I'll keep this brief here. Pooh's Playful Spot was relocated across the street to the queue for the Many Adventures of Winnie the Pooh, and in mid-2009, work walls went up and construction broke on the massive new expansion. On December 6, 2012, the new Fantasyland expansion opened to the public. While the main e-ticket of the land was kinda behind schedule, people loved the rest of the land. However, even though it was long gone, there are still numerous references to 20,000 Leagues throughout the land, but possibly the most interesting one is this, the show building for the popular Under the Sea Journey of the Little Mermaid dark ride. This show building happens to be in pretty much the exact same location of the former indoor portions of 20,000 Leagues. While the fanboys love this detail, unfortunately it's not the actual 1971 show building. That was demolished alongside the rest of the lagoon in 2004. But some other references include this nautilus carved into the tree from Playful Spot, this squid on the weather vane outside the Undersea Adventure, this nautilus carved into the rockwork in the queue for Undersea Adventure. But probably the most obscure tidbit is that during the press event for the opening of New Fantasyland, everyone in attendance was given a champagne glass filled with water from 20,000 Leagues Lagoon, which they were instructed to pour into the water feature in the queue. A nice touch, I guess, but still pretty weird and obscure. And that kinda brings us up to today. Out of the 3 sub-rides that were built, 2 remain. Kinda. While the Disneyland version got rethemed into the Finding Nemo Submarine Voyage in 2007, much of the original ride remained. But this video is already super long, so maybe I'll make a separate video on the Finding Nemo subs down the road. Anyway, with Disneyland as a whole not open, the subs aren't operating, and even when the park does eventually open back up, I doubt they'll come back immediately. Queues are always problematic, and they cram guests into tiny sealed chambers during a pandemic. No. Anyway, while Tokyo Disney Sea is open right now, 20,000 Leagues is unable to operate for the reasons I stated a few seconds ago. I'm sure the 2 rides will return at some point due to their popularity alone, but it may be a little while. With all that said, let's move on to the design segment. In order to properly memorialize this ride, I'm going to go scene by scene through it to preserve its memory. Let's begin. As you entered the Nautilus submarine, the load area was themed to Vulcania. This was done because, as I mentioned before, the load process for this ride was quite lengthy, and Disney felt it would be better for the show if the load waiting area was themed. As you exited the station, you were greeted by a massive marine life scene that took place over much of the outdoor portions of the ride. Such sights as fish, turtles, coral, eels, and many other fun aquatic displays greet you as you moved along your journey, all while Captain Nemo discussed the sea life. As you moved on, you could see divers as well as an octopus fighting a shark. Captain Nemo would announce that we're going deeper as we entered the show building, though this was not obvious to the guests. As you entered the show building, you were greeted by the Rock Canyon, which mainly served as a transitional area. Next, you would glide past the Graveyard of Lost Ships, as Captain Nemo described it, while we, being in a submarine, are exempt from the treacherous ocean storms, surface vessels are not so lucky. We then enter the Polar Ice Caps, which also feature an Aurora Borealis lighting effect. This is followed by a blacklight area. Captain Nemo describes it as a place so deep in the ocean that light could never get that far, though in reality, the only reason this area was dark was to hide the maintenance spur line which led to the attraction storage facility for the vehicles. As we exit this area, we hear probably one of the most famous lines from these rides.
Warning light, sir. We reached maximum depth limit.
Take her back up to 80 fathoms.
80 fathoms, aye, aye.
Though a slightly different reading than Disneyland's version, this line can also be found in Disneyland's incredible e-ticket-themed nighttime spectacular, Remember Dreams Come True.
Warning light, sir. We've reached maximum depth limit.
Ease her back up to 80 fathoms.
80 fathoms, aye, aye.
We would next enter the Lost City of Atlantis, which was a truly amazing set piece. This was followed by probably the most famous line in the ride.
Others treat any concept of Atlantis as pure fantasy, along with legends of sea serpents and mermaids.
Begging your pardon, sir, but did you say sea serpents are mere fantasies?
Belay there, mate. Anyone in his right mind knows there's no such thing as a sea serpent or mermaids. Mr. Baxter, if you think you're seeing mermaids and sea monsters, you've been submerged too long.
Okay, there's a lot to unpack here. First off, this segment was a direct clone of the piece in Disneyland's version, though that was true for a lot of this ride. But more importantly, while the Disneyland version of the sea serpent got saved and preserved to the point where I actually got the chance to see it a few years back, Walt Disney World did not get such treatment, and the figure was left to rot for a long time before being eventually destroyed. Shame. Also during the scene, Captain Nemo references a Mr. Baxter. This is a reference to Imagineering legend Tony Baxter, who was a lead on the project back in 1971. Anyway, after that encounter, we enter the treasury. Fairly self-explanatory there, this room is filled with tons of faux valuable treasures. This is followed by the tottering columns, also fairly self-explanatory. This portion of the ride was likely a tribute to the tottering rocks effect found in the Mine Train Through Nature's Wonderland, one of very few attractions not to be brought over to Florida in 1971 due to its declining popularity. As we carefully circumvent the tottering columns, we come to the most infamously terrifying scene in the ride, the giant squid attack. Once again, fairly self-explanatory, out of the potholes we viewed a fellow submarine caught in the grasp of a giant squid, the likes of which were very similar to the scene in Disneyland. While the squid was a very iconic piece of the attraction, unfortunately it just kind of rotted away when it was left abandoned for 10 years, and Disney came in and finished the job in 2004. Anyway, with the giant squid attack, we exit the show building and emerge back outside to view more of the picturesque marine life. After that, we arrive back at the station and the ride ends. Really an incredible experience. Let's move on to the conclusion. I vividly remember when this was number one on my closed Walt Disney World attractions top five list. I was so young and naive and ripping off pretty much every Disney review personality I saw. I just need to say that I was entirely wrong. I think the ride still belongs on the list, but maybe at number three. Because while this ride is incredible and its closure is an absolute tragedy, I don't think its closure changed the landscape of the resort the same way that the disappearance of Horizons or Journey into Imagination did. That said, losing this ride was a disaster. It was such an incredible attraction that had so much going for it. That said, I completely understand why it closed. This was a 5-acre, multi-million dollar attraction that took forever to load and cost so much to maintain. I love this ride, but come on, someone could have seen this coming from a mile away. Seeing this attraction closed in 1994 and was demolished when I was a one-year-old, I never had a chance to ride it. However, I have ridden the subs in Disneyland, Finding Nemo re-themed, but still it's mostly the same infrastructure. The idea of a submarine ride is such a classic Disney concept, and it's one that they do so well. I think what's important about these rides is that they are just so physical. This is not a runaway railway situation where everything's a screen and has zero dimension to it. This ride had physical props and animatronics, and that makes it an e-ticket. Not how much you spend on it, substance. Runaway Railway is not an e-ticket. Did it cost what an e-ticket may have cost? Maybe. Did Disney market it like an e-ticket for some reason? Also maybe. But either way, it's not an e-ticket. Even the Finding Nemo Submarine Voyage, which has a lot of screens, has physical props that make it special. Sure, the CGI fish are projections, but they are projected onto real-world objects. 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea Submarine Voyage was the epitome of an e-ticket ride. It's a unique concept, it's got millions of dollars worth of production value, and it's worth the wait. I believe that while this attraction was not the biggest loss Walt Disney World has ever seen, it's definitely the biggest loss the Magic Kingdom has seen to date. Sure, you could make an argument for Alien Encounter or Delta Dream Flight, and you certainly could make a solid argument for Spectro Magic, but ride-wise, I think this is the biggest loss. It certainly was the geographically biggest loss. Anyway, this attraction was incredible, and I'm very sad that it's gone. But I also completely get why they closed it. And New Fantasyland is very much a worthy successor. That area is incredible, and it features some of the most beautiful rides at the resort. Anyway, that's the 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea Submarine Voyage, a beautiful attraction with a rich history that will be long remembered for decades to come. Thank you for watching this episode of Remember the Magic. If you enjoyed it, please consider liking the video and maybe even subscribing to my YouTube channel. There are a lot of videos coming out real soon you won't want to miss, so be sure to click the bell icon so you get notified when we upload a new video. And remember, the answers to where we are going often lie in our past. Have a great, big, beautiful day, and remember, tomorrow is just a dream away.